First of all, I will explain to you string formatting. Up to now, we have been writing print statements. Let's write some here. Let's say, for example.
We can't see your screen.
Oh, sorry. What happened? I don't know. I will check again. My screen is shared. Okay. Do you see now?
Yes.
Okay. Till now, we have been writing print statements. Print, if we have, I have an integer, assume that I have an integer before that. A is equal to 24. I was just saying print A, or I was just saying, for example, number equal comma A, something like that. What happens is it just puts the number here. And between this item and that item, the print function prints a space. So after this equal sign, there will be a space. Let's print this. We see that there is a space here. After the equal sign, we have a space before the number. If I have, for example, another number, B, is a float number 3.14159, etc. Then when we print those, let's go top, or even that's what I will do. I will just okay. I will anyway. Let's put these comments to the end so that we will see more easily. And before that, let's put a print 40 times one equal sign. Okay. Now, when we do that, we see that there are spaces between items. Between the first item and the second item, a space is printed. Between the second and third, a space is printed, etc. And here we can have, for example, something like this. If I have, for example, another string, then between A and ABC, there will be a space. Between this and the other one, there will be another space. Of course, if I don't want any space between these two, these four items, I can put here sep equal this. Okay, so there will be no space between the items. Okay, this is the first string, this is the second integer variable A, and then we have ABC, and then the number which is stored in B. But sometimes I may want to have one space somewhere and no space in another place, etc. So this kind of printing, although there are some facilities, it cannot handle all the situations. Therefore, I would like to have, for example, let's assume that I have B with 10 digits after the decimal, but I'm only interested with the four digits after the decimal. I only want the first four digits. But when I use print, it's not possible to omit the remaining digits, okay? If, or let's say I have, for example, C is equal to 100 divided by 7. If I print C as well, okay? And this like that. Sorry, what is wrong? There is 2, comma. Then I have lots of digits here, okay? But I'm only interested, for example, for two digits after the decimal part for C and four digits for B. I only need four decimal digits. I want to print four decimal digits for B and only two decimal digits for C. But it's not possible in normal print. So what I can use formatting. Formatting is used to format the things nicely and have sometimes I have many lines with the same type of data. If I want them to be aligned equally, then I'm using string formatting. I will show you how we do that. In string formatting, there are several ways of string formatting, but I will show you the basic ones with the percent format placeholders. Percent %d is for integers. Percent %f is for floats. Percent %s is for strings, and percent %c is for single characters. And inside this percent %d has two more variations. I will show them all of them to you. Percent %f has some variations, and percent %s as well. Percent %c has no variation because it only prints a single character. So a single character is a single character. It doesn't have any variations, but the others have some variations. Assume that I want to print them, those numbers, like that. With format, not format, method with percent. Percent is for integers. When I want to format a number and print something like with formatting, I just use a format string. The format string is followed by percent. And if there is only one format identifier, this is called format identifier, percent %d or percent %060, etc., or percent for float numbers, percent %f, percent %16f, percent %.3f, etc. These are format identifiers or format placeholders. And those format placeholders, if there is only one placeholder in the format string, this is the format string, followed by percent. If there is only one, we just write the variable. If there are more than one, if there are two, three, four, for example, like here, percent %s is one string, percent %s is another string, or this is one form placeholder, this is another placeholder. Let's put as well here to print two numbers so that we will have print, assume that number one is percent %d, comma, and then directly after the number, I will print a comma, followed by number two is percent %d. If I have two format placeholders, then after percent, I have to put in here a tuple. So I open a parenthesis. I want to print n and k here. So n comma k, I place them between parentheses, okay? So the first one, this n, will be printed as the first format placeholder, and the second one will be printed at the position of the second format placeholder. Let's run this and see the result. Here I have my output, okay? 1, 2, 3, 4 is n, and 40,000 blah, blah, something is k. So I have them here like that. What are the variations? I can specify the number of positions that will be printed, the number of positions that will be used to print the number. If I put here percent %60, here it will reserve six positions, okay, six places, and print the number right justified. As you see, the n is equal to 1,234. We put after number is one space. Here we have our start of our string. This is here. And after that, I have percent %60. So it reserves six spaces and puts the number right aligned inside those six spaces. If I have 060, it again reserves six spaces, but also prints the left on the left hand left part the zeros, the leading zeros. Okay, so the number is printed not as 1,234, but it is printed as 001234. Okay, as you see here. If I have minus %8d, minus in a placeholder, it's the placeholder always starts with a percent, and it always ends with either D or F or S or C. Between percent and D, there may be either a number or a zero and a number or a minus and a number, okay? Here as well, we have similar features for F and D, but let's start with D. So percent D, with percent D we have basically, let's go here, create another one, another document. Here with percent D, I have, for example, only percent D. I can only use percent D or percent a number and D. But of course, I cannot put N here. I have to put a number here, okay? Either 7 or 3 or 5 or whatever. Or I can put percent 0 a number and then D. Or I can put here percent minus, for example, 7D. What happens here? The number is printed as it is. Here, 7 positions are reserved for the number, and the number is right aligned inside those 7 positions. When I have percent 0,7D, it reserves 7 places, prints the number, and fills the leading spaces with zeros. If I have minus 7D, it reserves 7 spaces. Let's do it something like that. Let's choose this. Let me go here. I will make just choose Korean U and bold. I will show you, if assume that the number is, for example, 1, 2, 3, 4. So here, what it will produce, assume that the number is this one, it will just print as 1, 2, 3, 4 to the screen. But here, it will just put, since this is 4-digit number, since I'm using 7D, it will just put 1, 2, 3 spaces, and then 1, 2, 3, 4. It will use 7 positions in the output. Again, this also will use 7 positions, but since there's a 0 here, instead of putting spaces before the number, it will put zeros and then the number itself. And here, here what it will do, it will print the number right aligned on those 7 positions and then put spaces afterwards. Minus means left aligned, okay? The number is left aligned here, not right aligned. Sorry, I'm correcting. If you put nothing, it is right aligned. If you put minus, then it is left aligned. And this is valid for strings as well. Let's jump back directly to S. Assume that I have a string, okay? Assume that my string is, for example, ABBA. And then if I have percent S, what I will do, I will just copy this here. If I have percent S, percent 7S, 0 is not meaningful for strings, but ABBA will be printed here, okay? ABBA. If I have, for example, 7S, there will be 3, of course, this is capital A, then it will be like this, the output. It will reserve 7 positions in the output and put the string right aligned. If I have minus 7 percent minus 7S, then it will reserve 7 spaces and put the word or the string left aligned. Okay, this is right aligned, this is left aligned. So for F, let's do things for F as well. Control C, let's put here F, let's put here 10F, 0, 10F, and we have other variations, minus, not, 0.2F, etc. And let's put here a number, 3.14159. This is our number. This is pi p to 10 digits after the decimal. If I use this, it will just print the number as it is, okay? If I use 10F, what it will do, it will use 10 positions. Let's try to do it here in our program. Let's go here. Boom, boom, boom. Let's use here P is equal to 3. Okay, let's take this one and let's print something. AAA equal percent. I'm not putting any spaces, or let's put a space here. And then F here. Let's see what will happen. Percent P, and I will just copy the same statement and I will create some variations of this. And of course, let's take this and put here. Now, instead of F, I will put, for example, 10F. Minus 10F, let's see if this will be left aligning that. We will see the result. Here, I will put minus, for example, 4F. And what was the last one that I was doing? 0, 10F. Okay, let's copy this. And here, let's put 0, 10S and the rest. Now, here we see the results. By the way, when you just print a number with percent F, and also let's do one more thing, print just A as it is, okay? Let's see the outcome. Sorry, not A, of course, P, sorry. Here we see that it printed all the digits. When we use percent F, the default in Python for percent F is 6 digits after the decimal. Here we see that 6 digits are only printed. If I say 0.4F, it only prints 4 digits. If I want to print only a limited number of a certain number, a number of digits that I want to print, then I put just percent dot the number of decimal digits and F. This is most frequently used formatting, and I will have here 12.4F to show the two most common used ones are this formatting for real numbers or float numbers and this formatting. These two are most common used ones. For 10F, it reserves 10 positions in the output. Since the default is 6 digits after the decimal, then there is one position that is used by the decimal dot, and then 3 places are left for the integral part. Therefore, since the number is 3, it puts 2 space and then the rest. Assume that I want to print with 10F a number which has more than 3 digits before. Okay. Assume that here I will write some number dot a number. Okay, something like this. And let's see what will happen. In that case, it does not obey. It doesn't mischief you. It doesn't give false impression to you. It doesn't print false number. If the number of integral parts doesn't fit, oh, sorry, I will print this. I made a mistake. Just take this X and put here, okay? I was just speaking about ten point four F. Okay, this is what I was speaking. I have here 10.4F. 4 position is for the decimal part, and no, 4 or 6F, point F. Yep, that's 10F. That's correct. 10F. Since the default is 6 decimal digits after the in the decimal part, 1 for the decimal point itself, 7. So 3 places is left to fill up 10. And when we look to the outcome, we have this, okay? It doesn't, in this case, it doesn't truncate, it doesn't omit 2 and 3. It doesn't only print 541 dot blah blah blah, it prints the whole number in that case. It doesn't obey if this number of positions doesn't fit the number to be printed. But if it is something like this, 41 blah blah, then in this case it obeys and reserves 10 spaces since there are 6 point decimal digits printed after the decimal part. In the decimal part, here only 6 digits are printed, 1 for the decimal point, 7. So 3 positions are left here. So since the number is 41, it prints 1 space and 41. With zeros, blah, blah, as you see, with 010F, it prints the lead, instead of printing leading spaces, it prints leading zeros when there is a zero leading the format, okay? Always it starts with percent, and for float numbers it always ends with F, and between percent and F we can have some variations: the number of positions that will be used to print the number, the number of decimals to be printed, as here. If we say percent dot for F, it means that just print 4 decimals and then whatever the number is, then print the rest. So if it is 3 point blah blah, it will print that. If it was 243, it will print like this. In each case, it will only print 4 decimal digits, and the rest just will fit to the output, will be printed to the output. Here we have 12.4F, so 12 positions are reserved. Okay, 12 positions are reserved. Dot 4F means 4 decimals will be printed. 4 decimals plus 1 dot sign 5. So subtract from 12, 5. Therefore, 7 digits will be used to print the integral part. Okay. Why do we use this? I will show you the example here. I will just run this program again. Here, for example, we have some data, okay? If I want to print multiple data like this, either to a file or to screen, I need formatting, okay? When I use formatting, whether the number is long or short, I can just align them nicely, as here, okay? Assume that this is the number of books that are read by the person. Jorge Luis Borges is an Argentinian writer who had read more than 6,000, maybe 10,000 books was read by him. This is my son, etc. Anyway, assume that we have some data and we want to print them like this, well aligned. If I just print them normally with one space between them, it will be something like that. The name and then one space, the weight and books, this is the weight and this is the weight, this is the books, etc., the number of books read, etc. But if I'm not using formatting, my output will be something like that, which will be difficult to read, okay, difficult to understand. But if I print like this, it will be much easier to understand the output. How do I do this? First of all, I have a string. Let me show you, just jump there. Here I have this. This part prints this, okay? Minus 20s, 20 spaces are reserved for the name. Since there is minus, it left aligns. So Halil Özmen is aligned to the left of those 20. If I just say percent 20s, it will just reserve 20 spaces, but it will right align. So depending on my preference, I can either right align the names like this or left align. When I want to left align, I use minus. And then I have 7.2f. I reserve 7 places and just two decimals are printed, so 24 is printed, two decimals are printed, plus one for the decimal sign, and then since the total is seven, up to one, and up to four digits, four integral digits, it can be printed. Since there is probably there is no person who is who has more weight than 9,999 kilograms, this will be enough for a normal person. And then 5D is for the number of books. Here we have our 5D, five positions, and it is right aligned, okay? And there, of course, there is one space. Here we have one space between these two, and then one another space, etc., etc. Okay? So this is how we why we use formatting, just to have a well-readable output. This could be also to a screen or to a file, but in either case, if we use formatting like this, we can have well readable output. There is also a format method that I will very quickly go over that. Another one is we have a format string followed by dot format method, and as parameters we have several, one or more parameters. In this case, the parameters go and replace the formats that are put with curly braces. This is not as useful as this one, okay? The percent formatting is has more advantages than this one, but this is also used by some people. Here, there are several ways of doing that. If you don't put any of these, okay, you can put it like this. First format, second format, third format. Of course, this string, format string, in this case, has to be followed by the format method. This is the format method per, way of formatting. And this is formatting by percent format placeholders. So there are two ways of formatting: using format placeholders, percent %e, percent %f, percent %s, percent %c, and the other one is the format method. Okay, there are two methods of formatting. In this one, if I have, this can be double quotation mark. No, either double or single quotation mark are perfectly okay. It doesn't matter. There may be here placeholders. This is the format placeholders. The first one will go to the first one, the second one will go to the second place, the third will go to the third place. Or I can put here numbers 0, 1, 2. The first one will go to zeroth placeholder, the second one will go to the this one, etc. But here you don't have control over the number of spaces or over the number of decimal parts to be printed, etc. The just it prints as it is, okay? If I put here, for example, 2 and 1, what will happen? A will be printed here. B is the second item, which is index 1, will be printed here. B will be printed here. And C will be printed here. Of course, here there are some other characters. I just put dot, 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 but think that there are other characters here, okay? Not just dots, but some other words or sentences or whatever. So if I use 0, 1, 2, the first thing in the format, in the parameter of the format method is for 0. This is for B, 1, 2, etc. If there's a D here, and probably we will have something like 3 here, okay? If I just put here something similar to that, then I can have here D. So this one will go to the first, B will go to the second, C will go to the third, and D will go to the fourth one. In this case, A will go to the format with 0, B will go to the format with 1, will be printed here, C will be printed here, it's the format which has number 2, and D will be printed here, which has number 3. Okay. And here, contrary to this one, you don't have control over the number of decimal digits or number of spaces reserved to be printed, etc. So personally, I prefer this way of printing. You have more control over what you print and how you print. Okay, not what you print, but how you print. This is about printing, formatting. Sorry, string formatting, formatting numbers inside strings. Of course, instead of printing them, what you can do, this generates a string. What I can do, I can have s is equal to, let's take something like this. Okay. This generates a string. So instead of using this, what I can do, minus %t, here I can have, for example, s. Okay, this is also possible. It's not only used in print statements. This percent way of formatting produces a string. This produces a string, and then we can print that string. Okay. Assume I want to have. I will show you one more thing. Assume I have, for example, a comma b comma c equal 1, 2, 4, and I want to print with %d %d %d. Percent, of course, since I have 3 items here, I have to put parentheses, and here I put a comma b comma c. Let's see what will be the output. Where is my output? Here it is. Okay, 1, 2, 4. As you see, I said just put the number a here, put the number b here, and put the number b c here. And there is no space between them, okay? So my output will be something like that. 1, 2, and 4 are printed according to this format. If I want to have here, for example, this, and then here after the second one, this one, what will be the output? It will be 1, these characters, followed by the second number, followed by the characters between the second and third format placeholder, and then the third number is printed as using the %d format. So I have this. If I have, for example, 04d, 05d, 06d, so the first number will be printed on 4 positions with leading zeros. It will be 0001. The second number will be placed on 5 positions with leading zeros. So since the number is 2, it will be 4 zeros followed by 2. And C is printed with %60. The number is 4. So it will be 5 spaces followed by 4. As we see here. Okay. So this is the end of my string formatting explanations. Do you have any questions about these? If your output is to a file, it is quite useful to use format placeholders or format identifiers. They are called either format placeholders or format identifiers. Then you have full control how you print, especially numbers or strings with some, for example, like here, you can reserve many spaces and put string left justified so that you have a nice readable output. Okay, let's move on to lists. Until now, we have seen data structures which only contains one element, like an integer number or a float number or a string or a character or a boolean. But if frequently while we write programs, we manipulate many data, and most of the time, if we have too much data, it's not possible to create many variables. And even if you write a program with many variables, it will not handle multiple data in most cases. If we don't know at the beginning, when we write the program, if we don't know how many, for example, if we are dealing with students in a class, if I don't know how many students are there in the class in a, while writing a program, I cannot write many variables for those. In those cases, I have to use data structures which will contain multiple objects, multiple data. So a list is one of the most common ones in Python. A list contains zero or more objects. By objects, we can also think about integers, float numbers, strings, and other things as well. A list contains zero or more objects. It can be an empty list. In this case, it will contain zero. It can contain only one object, two object, three object, or many other objects. When we write a list, we just start with a square bracket and end with a square bracket. And inside the square brackets, we write the data elements or expressions separated by comma. For example, 31, 28, 31, 30, blah, blah, blah. These are the number of days in months. I have here 12 elements. The first one is the number of days in January, number of days in February, etc., and number of days in December. I have a list which contains 12 values. I will not explain this. These are about some other things. I will continue with this. How do we get, okay, assume that we created a list like this. There are several ways of creating. Either we can create a list using square brackets, or we can create a list using the list function. List function creates a list. By the way, before we have seen that we have sum function, max function, min function, etc. And it is a good practice not to use function names as variables. In my program, it's not advised to, let's close this. Oops, I shouldn't close, okay. Let's go here, list py. I shouldn't use a variable named list or a list named list because list is the name of a function. If I use this as a as a list name or a variable name, later on, I will not be able to use the list function, okay? Here, if I use list like this, somewhere else, I cannot say a is equal to list blah, 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 okay? Because there will be a conflict between this and this. It is a good practice not to use the function name as variable name. Either put here my list, or you can just say list one or whatever, okay? My program was with my list. I will leave it like that. So it is advised not to use the names of the functions. List is a function to create lists. Tuple is a function to create tuples. Dict, D-I-C-T, is a function to create dictionaries, etc. It is advised not to use those function names as list names. For example, list and this will be, it may create some problems. Anyway, said that, here I'm creating a list which contains several numbers. When we print that list, we have that list created here, okay? Here, we can address single elements in a list. The elements in a list are indexed, and the index of the first element is 0, the index of the second element is 1, 2, etc. So it starts with 0, 0, 1, 2, it goes like this. Here, if I just want to print the element with index 2, which is the third element, what I do, I use my list with square brackets, I put the index. So the index at index 2, which is the number at index 2? It is 84, and 84 is printed here, as we see. Here, we want to change an element. Here, at index 3, we have 90. I want to change this element to something else. What I will do, I will use indexing and assignment to that element. Okay, here I have assignment to an element of the list. So my list 3 equal 94 will find the element with index 3. Okay, with element index 3 is this one. It will update that element. It will change, modify that element. This 90 will become 94 when it is printed. Again, here we see that now it's not 90 anymore. It is 94. So using indexing, we can either get or use elements in a list, or through assignment and indexing, we can update or modify elements in a list. The lists are mutable objects, so we can change elements in a list. Tuples, on the other hand, are unmutable. In a tuple, we cannot change any element, okay? The difference between a list and a tuple is that lists are changeable, are mutable, but tuples are unmutable. You cannot modify a tuple. What we can do with a list, we can add new elements. Here I have several elements. I want to add new element to the end. Okay, I want to add 70. What I do, I say I use the append method, my list.append, and I put here something, and that is added to the list. By the way, let's put here a string. Okay, let's run this. Here we will see that now our list, we had only numbers originally, and here we added a string. In Python, it is possible to have a mixture of different data types in a list. Okay, so my list now has several numbers and a string. This is possible. Let's put here our original value. We can also insert elements inside the list. Append adds to the end of the list, and insert is used to insert an element inside the list. If I have 4, where is index 4? Index 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 64, 66 is at position 4. If I want to insert here an element, a value, then what I use, my list.insert 4, 44, at position 4, 44 is inserted. So here at this position, 44 is inserted. So all the rest moved one position further, and 44 is inserted to index 4. Okay, at index 4 now, the new value is 44, and all the rest have shifted. We have del construct to delete elements from a list. If I want to delete, for example, this 84, which is at index 2, what do I do? What I said, del my list 2 will delete 84, or my del my list 3, 0, 1, 2, 3. Here, this 94 is at index position 3. So after del my list 3, what is the new version, the new list? 94 is removed, 44 is moved to index 3, 66 is moved here. So this is deleted from the list, and all the remaining elements have shifted one position backwards. This is after the deletion of the third element, we have this. Let's run this again. Instead of above, let's see our 70. Okay. How do we get elements? There are two ways of getting elements of a list. This is one. This one is more simple. I just write a for loop with a variable and then in keyword and the list. what happens in this case, every element in the list is taken one by one, stored into this variable, and the loop is repeated. Okay, it can be one line or multiple lines, doesn't matter. The loop will be repeated for each element of the list to be stored in the variable here in the for loop. So the first element, 48, will be taken, put into X, will be printed, and here you see there is a comma and space, so 48 is printed, followed by a comma space, and then second element is taken, printed, etc., etc. Those elements are one by one taken and printed. Assume that we don't have comma. Let's put here something like that. One space, two minus, and one space. When we run this, we have this, okay? Between them, we have now this. Of course, after the last element, well, after the last element is printed, we have this again, and print will go to the next line. Since here end equal this means that instead of printing new line after printing the elements, don't go to the next line, just instead print one space, two minus, and one space, those four characters. So this will stay on the same line, and here we move to the next line. So after this, with this print on line 37, we move to the next line, and this equals are printed with this comment on the line 38. This is one way of getting all elements. Another way of getting all elements is by using indexing. How do we get all indexes? To get all indexes, we use range and then the len. The len function as parameter a list gives us the number of elements in a list. Okay? It gives us the length of the list, or in other words, the number of elements in a list. So range len will produce all the numbers from zero to the length of the list, excluding it. If the list has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 numbers, okay, here we have 8 numbers. So len my list will produce range 8, will produce numbers from 0 to 7, which will be valid indexes for the list. Okay, since the index starts from 0, if there are 8 numbers, the index of the last one will be naturally 7, 0 to 7. So here, what I do, I use indexing to print the elements. Len of my list will give you the number of elements. With range, we produce numbers from 0 till that number, excluding the length, and then with each number stored into J, the J now are indexes, I print the element, an element of the list using indexing. And here I have again this, instead of comma, let's put space, so there will be one space between after each. Here we are the output of that line loop on 32 and 33. Here I have another list which contains just the names of the months. And if month is 5, then month will display June. Why? The fifth month is May, but the indexes start from 0. So January has index 0, therefore May has index 4. And then naturally June has index 5. If you want to, here as you see, I have a comma, and then I move to the next line. Since I have started a list with curly brace, then after a comma, I can continue on another line until I finish with closing curly brace. Square bracket. So 11 is the last month. It will print December. What I could do, let me show this one. Here are the month days. And when I print the month days of 2, it will print 31. It's not February it is March, because January will be 0, February will be 1, index will have index 1, etc. And in order to prevent this, what we can do? If I put here one empty string at the beginning, and here if I put, for example, 0 at the beginning, what will happen? My list will have not 12 elements, but will have 13 elements. But in this case, January will be at index position 1. December will be at index position 13, okay? If I do this, now when I print with 5, month 5, here this, the output of this is here, May, okay? Fifth month is May. 11th month is November. This is possible now because I've inserted one dummy element at the beginning of the list. So this has index 0, January will have index 1. Similarly, this will have index 0. I will not use this one. I will use the rest. I will have a dummy value at the start of my list. So if you wish, you can do something like this in your program. Boom, 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 boom. Here we are printing months and month days. Here 00 is the dummy one, and here we have our month names and month days. Since both have equal number of elements, we take one element from one list and an element from the other list which has the same index value. 0 and 0, or 1 and 1, 2 and 2, okay, etc. until 12 and 12. So here we are, we have this output. Of course, since we have this space and this 0, it will be, they will print it here. Empty string and 0. Here we have an expression to check for the leap year. Okay, I put it here. If the year is a leap year, then the number of days for February is 2. So for month days for this is, as you see, it is 29. I will not explain this, blah, blah, blah. Okay, what is count method? Count method counts the number of elements which are equal to its parameter. By the way, a list may contain the same values over and over again. For example, in this list here, we can have more than 148, okay? Let's put here another 48. I have here 48, 48, and 48. A list may contain duplicate values. It doesn't matter. This is at index position 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. At index position 4, we again have 48, 5, 6. At index position 6, we have again 48. It doesn't matter. These are ordered, okay? And it starts with index position 0, and the same value may repeat in a list. There is no problem with lists. And a list may contain duplicate values. Let's leave it like this. So with count method, we can count how many of the elements are equal to this value. Here we are counting in month days. Month days is a list, as we know. Here we have that. If I just say month days that count 31, I will be finding the number of elements that are equal to 31. And here month days that count will give me an integer value which will be equal to the number of elements that are equal to 30. Let me look here. We have seen len is the length of the list. I'm just looking. Append is to append to the end of the list. And yeah, let's come here. We can create a list using the list function and range function. Here we have the list function, and as parameter we have a range function call. Here, this range function call has parameters 10, 101, and 10. Which numbers will it generate? It will generate 10, 20, 30, 40, 90, and 100 at the end. It is up to 101, and each time it increases by 10. Starts by 10, start by 10, increase by 10, as long as it is less than 101. So the values that will be generated with this range will be 10, 20, 30, blah, blah, up to 100. Of course, this will be not here. Let's put it here. Generate a list containing, this will generate a list containing 0, 1, 2, dot, 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 9. Why? Because range 10 will generate numbers from 0 to 9. So this will generate numbers from 0 to 9. And from those values, create a list. List function is used to create a list. So from these numbers generated by the range function, we create a list, and NN will be a list containing 0 to 9. Where it is here. Okay. Let's put here 0 to 9. So it will be more explanatory. It will be easier to find where it is. Yeah, here, 0 to 9. We have printed that. Now, here we have a list, and the list contains from 10 to 100, because this range will produce the values from 10 to 100. And then here, we go and change the element with index 2. The element with index 2 is 30. Index 0, index 1, index 2, change this to 32, then it is changed. Here what we do, modify all elements. Here we are modifying all elements of a list. For j in range len of numstan, numstan is our list, okay, numstan is our list. Here we will be modifying the elements. What we do, we say nums 10j, the jth element is assigned which value? It's assigned its original value multiplied by 2. So the list was this one. After this for loop, the list will become this. 10 becomes 20, 20 becomes 40, 32 becomes 64, etc., etc. And 100 will become 200. Here we are modifying those values. Now, let me write one more thing here. Instead of this, we have seen that for example, A in nums 10, okay? What happens if you say A is equal to A multiplied by 2? I get each element of nums 10 put into A and take the double of A. And let's print nums 10 here after this. Okay. And let's see the result. Where it is here. Here we have printed, after changing to 32, we have printed. It is printed here. And here we are printing nums 10 once again. And it is the next one. As we see, when we use this type of loop and modify that element, it does not change the elements of the list. Why? Because it takes the value of an element from nums 10, put into the variable A. This only changes the variable A. It does not change the list, okay? It just copies an element from list into a variable, and it changes that variable. So it is not related with the list anymore. It is just copied from list to a variable, and the variable is changed. So nums 10 will not be affected with that. So if I want to change the elements of a list, I have to build that type of loop with indexes and with range len parentheses, the list inside the as parameter of the len method. And then I use indexing to modify the elements. List of strings, we can have some list of strings, print these, blah, blah, blah. Here the same thing with indexes. Instead of unlat, yeah, here I just deliberately put something wrong. 0, 1, 2 are indexes. And for cities 2, change the element with index 2 with this one. When we print it, this is Anlatya and this is Antalya. List methods. We have seen insert, extend. What is extend? Extend is used to add elements of a list to the end of another list. And we have here our list NN, okay? We have a list NN, and we have another list MM. What do? We add the elements of MM to the end of NN, okay? So when we look here, what I will do, just put here NN, comma this, and let's put here MM, this, so that we can see NN and MM somewhere here. Here, NN. This is our NN. This is our MM. And after extend MM, what happens? The elements of MM are appended to the end of NN. So NN is grows. Here we have 8, 12, 16 in MM. And we have 0, 1, blah, 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 up to 9 in MM. So after 9, this 8, 12, 16 are added, okay, are appended. So these are the appended elements to original list. So after NN extend MM, the elements of MM are added to the end of NN. It grows the list given here. Append, we have seen this, blah, blah, blah. Index. What does index method do? Index method finds the first occurrence of a value in a list. For example, for this list, if I do nn.index 4, what I will get? 4 is at position 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 is at position 4. Okay. So I will get 4. Or for this one, 44 is here at position 0, 1, 2, 3. This is index 3. When I use lst.index 44, I will get the value 3, which is the first, the position of the, or the index of the first occurrence of 44 inside the list. I can have another one here, for example. This can be also 44, okay? Assume that there are two 44. Index will give us the index method will give us the index of the first occurrence of 44. If that value doesn't exist, this gives us an error. So usually before getting the index, what we have to do, we have to check if that value exists in a list. In order to check if some value exists in a list, we use this kind of if. If here we have our value in list. Does 60 exist in list? If 60 is inside LST, this condition will give us true. If 60 does not exist in LST, this will give us false. Okay. This is how we do. This is about checking if an element exists or not. We use this kind of if some value or a variable which contains some value, if that value exists in a list or not, we use in and the list name. This will give us true, I repeat again, this will give us true if the value here exists in the list. It will give us false if it doesn't exist. Let me go to my Python lecture notes, deleting list operator. Okay, I've not shown you the plus and multiply. If I have two lists, one list and another list, what I can do, I can create a new list using the first list plus the second list. If I use plus operator with two lists, list one plus list two, what will happen? It will create a new list which will contain first of all elements of the list one and then continuing with all elements of list two. Okay, this creates a new list which contains all elements. Of course, we can write something like this. If I have more than three lists, list final equal, for example, LST1 plus LST2 plus LST3 plus LST4. What will happen? It will contain all elements of the list one, continuing with all elements of the list two, continuing with all elements of list three, continuing with all elements of list four. It will create a new list, and then I'm assigning that new created list to list final. Okay, so we can have multiple addition of lists together. If I have multiplication, in that case, if one operand is list, the other operand must be an integer number. If I have, for example, this list 7 and 2 multiplied by 4, what will happen? 7 to 1, 7 to twice, 7 to 3 times, 7 to 4 times. It will repeat the elements that many times. So it will create a new list. Okay. So we can have plus and asterisk operators with lists to add either two or more lists together to get a new list, a bigger list, or we can have again a bigger list in which the elements of a list are repeated that much time. Of course, it doesn't create produce 7777 and then 42222. No, 7272727. Be careful about that. It doesn't repeat 7 4 times and then 2 4 times. No, it takes 7 and 2 and then 7 and 2 again, 7 and 2 again, etc. This list is not same thing with 7777 2222. They are two different lists. The order is important. We can use the in construct, in operator, to check if a value exists in a list or not. Here we have seen append to add to an element to the end of the list, insert to insert an element inside a list to a given index position. Extend is used to append multiple elements from another list to the end of the to a list. Count is to check to count how many times the value occurs in the list. Index is used to find the index position of a value in a list. Of course, if the value doesn't exist in the list, an error is raised. So we have to use this with this kind of, before using index, it is a good practice to have an if statement. If the element exists in the list, then take its index value. Otherwise, if the value does not exist in the list, the program will crash. Okay, it will give us an error. We can search and get index value of a value starting from a beginning index instead of looking from the beginning the whole list. We can have, for example, assume that we have a list. Let's go here. LST is equal to 4, let's put here some values. Now, instead of looking for For example, I'm looking for 4, not starting from the beginning, but starting from someplace else, okay? So what I can write in my program k index position of lst.index look for starting from position, for example, 5. What does this mean? Now let's put here the index values. This is index 0, index 1, index 2. I'm writing the index values of the elements on top, okay? This index 5, index 6, index 7, 8, and 9. When I do this, for search and get the index of 4, starting from position 5. So what, where is 5? It is here. Among these, it will look for 4, and it will return the index of 4. Since there is no 4 here, okay, I will not get anything. I will get an error message. But if I put here, for example, 2, so 2 is here. So this is the elements starting from index 2. Here there is a 4, I will get 3, okay? So if I have a beginning index, then it doesn't start finding the index of the element starting from 0, but it starts from that index. It starts from 5, here it will go and look in this part. And similarly, I can have 2, 5. What will happen? Here it will search the elements from 2 to 4. Is there any 4 between element 2 to 5? 5 is exclusive. Again, start is inclusive, end is exclusive. So it will look and try to find the index of 4, the first occurrence of index of 4 here. If I have, for example, something like that, 8, okay. So what will happen? Start from 2 until 8, exclusive. So from here to 7, index 7. Here there are 4 here and another 4 here. What it will return? It will return the index of the first occurrence of 4. So it will give me 3. Pop removes the last element and returns that last element. Or we can just delete ith element, an element with index I, and get it using pop I, remove and v. When we use remove v, but let's do it here. Assume that I'm using, for example, lst.remove 12. What will happen if there are more than 112? Index 10. There is 112 here, another 12 here. Remove method finds and removes the first occurrence. So this 12 is removed. That is removed. The list will continue with the other elements. Copy. It gets a copy of a list. For example, I assume that I want to have LST, a copy of the first list. LST equals LST, LST2 equals LST1 is not getting a new copy. This is just points to the same list, okay? If I have LST, something like this, and if I have LST2 equals LST, what happens? LST and LST2 points to the same and one single list. There are no two lists. But if I want to have another list, what I do, I just say LST copy this. In this case, a new list is created with the same values, but now there are two copies. I can change LST and LST2 will not be affected. I can change LST2 and LST is not affected. If I just do this, LST is equal to LST, LST2 is equal to LST. In this case, if sometime later on I add an element to LST, then LST2 will also modify, will be modified. Why? Because in this case, both LST and LST2 refers to the same list. It is not a copy, it is same and one list. If I just append this, it will append, it will change LST2. If I say LST2.append 99, then LST is also affected because it's only one list which is modified. Okay, the same list is modified, and both LST2 and LST refers to the same one list. But if I want to have a different, a copy, what I do, if I do this now, I get a copy of LST. So another one is created, and LST points to that new created list. When we change LST, LST2 is not affected. When we change LST2, LST is not affected. They are now two different copies. So if I want to have a two different copies, or a copy of one list and change the new list, then what I have to do, I have to use the copy method. Okay, is this understood? I have to be quick. Reverse reverses the order. The last element becomes the first element, etc. Sort the values in a list. Sort reverse equal to sorts in descending order. Clear deletes all elements in a list. Then we know that gives the blah blah. You can just see this. If I have a tuple, I can convert it to a list using list method, list function. Max get the maximum value in a list. Min gets the minimum value in a list. In these cases, all the elements must be of the same type. Either all of them must be number type or string type. Okay. If some are number and some are string, max and min will not work, and sum will not work. Sum only works for the numeric lists. Sorted returns a copy of a list where all items are sorted. Slicing is very similar to string slicing. When we have, for example, 2: nothing, it will start from index 2 and go to the end and take all the elements from to the end. It will give us a new list. Okay, this will give us a new list. Nothing, 4 will start from index 0 until 4 exclusive. So it will take the values with index 0, 1, 2, and 3. It will create a new list which only contains the elements of list 1 with indexes 0, 1, 2, and 3. This will get a new list from list 1 where the elements with index 2 and 3 are taken. 4 is exclusive. Minus 3 is starting from the end. The last one is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. So minus 3, nothing, means that till the end, starting from minus 3 index, which is the third one from the end, till the end. So it will be 7, 1, and 6 in this case. When we have three elements, something, colon, something, colon, something, and then the next one is the increment. Here, nothing, nothing means start of the list, end of the list, and each time increment the index with 2, it will take 4, jump by 2, it will jump to 3, jump 2 indexes, 8, then 9, then 1. So this expression gives us the even indexed elements. It will create a new list which only contains the even indexed elements of the original list. And if I have here this one, if I have a negative increment at the third position in the slicing, then the first one will be the end, the second one will be the start, because it is going backwards. And when we write it like this, slicing with nothing, nothing, and minus one as the three elements of the slicing, then it reverses, it gets a reverse of the list. Do I have other examples? Let me do here some examples about this. For example, if I have something like this, I have an expression, LST. 2, 7, 3. What are the elements that will be taken? 2 is this one. We start with this. 5 is taken, okay? This will create a new list which will contain 5. And then it will jump 3 indexes. From 2 at 3, it will go to 5. It will take 12. Move 3 indexes forward, go to 8. But 8 is equal or greater than 7, then this will be the end, okay? Oh, sorry, I made a mistake. Sorry, when in slicing, we don't have commas, but colons, okay? So let's do a more simple one. If I have just 2 and 7, what will be the result? 2 and 7, start with 2, go to till 7, exclusive till 7. So it will take these elements. New list will contain those elements, okay? 2 to 6. Let's copy this here. Now, 7 to 2 and -1. What will be our result? What is the element with index 7? It is 94. It will be taken, 94. And then we move backward, -1. We will go from 7 to index 6, 5, 4, 3. When we reach 2, we will not take it. This is exclusive. So we will have 94, then 4, then 12, then 8, and then 4 again. 94, go 1 backwards, 14, go 1 back, 12, 8, and 4. When we reach index 2, we will stop. So the last element will have index 3. Is this understood? Comprehension. This is a quite interesting thing. Probably I will explain this with, do I have any comprehension, list comprehension? Yeah, I have something like that. Comprehension is quite interesting way of creating lists. Here I have X. This is, as you know, the power operator and 2. This is X squared, the power 2 of X, for X in range 1, 11. What is range 1, 11 produces? It produces all numbers from 1 to 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 10. And here I have square brackets, which means that I have here a list. But inside, strangely, inside my list, I have a for statement. But here there is one thing. This is a comprehension. This is called list comprehension. Here we have an expression. And the variable used in this expression is used in a for statement. Here, since the range contains 1 and 11, the values of X will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 10. And here what we do, we get square of 2 of X. So we get square of 1, which is 1. Square of 2, 4. Square of 3, 9. So with this, we get the squares of numbers from 1 to 10 in a list. Let's run this. As we see here, I have a list which contain the squares of elements produced by this for list, for loop. Boom, boom, boom. What we can do? For example, we assume that I want to have something like this. 0.5, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, etc. From 0.5 to till 10. If I create here another list, A is equal to list for example, range 1, 21 will produce numbers from 1 to 20, okay? This will produce numbers from 1 to 20 in a list. But what I'm interested in half of those. So I cannot use lists like this. What I do, I just put here this, and here put x divided by 2, which will give me half of x for x in range. And of course, instead of parentheses, I put this. And let's print this here. This way, I will be getting 0.51, 1.52, blah, blah, blah. Since range only produces integers, but I want to produce some real numbers in a well-defined sequence, I can use list comprehension, okay? But how does it work? Here, we have a loop which generates some numbers, and those numbers are put into X from 1 to 20. And using those numbers, I have here an expression. The result of this expression is stored into the list. So for 1, 1 over 2 is 0.5. The next time in this for loop, the next value of x is 2. 2 divided by 2 is 1.0. Next time it is 3. 3 divided by 2 is 1.5, etc. So using comprehension, I can easily create lists which contain, which is not just in a well-defined, which is not incremented in the same, which contains not only integers but float numbers, or even if it's integers, it is not just in a normal sequence. Like, for example, if I have A is equal to list and range 1, 11, I can have this, or I can have, for example, 100, 1000, 100. What it will produce? It will produce all numbers from, it will produce numbers from 100. Then 200, until 900, okay? Because they have to be less than 1,000, and each time we increment by that. If we have this kind of sequences of numbers which have fixed increments between them, then we can use list. But if the here, it is not like that. It is between 1 and 4, there is 3. Between 4 and 5, 9, there is 5, and here we have just squares of some numbers. Then in this case, in this type of cases where the increment is not fixed, we can use those. Or if the increment is fixed, but I am not interested in integer numbers, but in float numbers, I want to get not 100, but 100 and 0, and not 200, but not 200 and 0. But range function produces only integer numbers. What do I have to do for producing this at the end, 900.0? I want to get the real numbers from 100 to 900 with 100 increment. Since range only produces integer numbers, I have to use comprehension. So instead of list, I just remove this, put here this. Square bracket, and at the end, square bracket. And here, I have something for x in this. And here, since 100 to 1000 with increment of 10 is put into x, x is here an integer value, but I'm interested in x multiplied by 1.0. When I multiply something with 1.0, I will get a float number. Let's print this here. Let's copy this here, run this. Here we see that now we have float numbers, okay? Not integer numbers, but float numbers. So for those type of cases, we use comprehension. Here we put a for loop, and using the variable here, we write here an expression, and each expression generated with the changing values of x will be stored into the list. Here I have for x 1 to 2, for y 7 to 8. Now I have 2, 4. This 4 is nested in this 4. So what will happen? This 4 will have x in 1, 2. I made a mistake here. What is my... No, sorry. This is a list. Okay, this is not a range. Sorry, I made a mistake. This is a list. Let's change this to from 1 and 2 to 2 and 3. So here, what this loop will do, it will get the elements of the list. This is a list. Since we have seen today that in a for loop with for a variable in a list, it will take each element from the list and put into x. So the first time, x will contain 2. The next time, x will contain 3. And inside this for loop, we have a nested for loop, which contains this. And here we have another, again, a list, 7 and 8. And each element is taken from the list and put into y. What do we have here? X multiplied by y. So what will happen? X will be 2. Y will be 7. 2 times 7, 14. 2, and then this, since this is the inner loop, this will continue. X was 2, 2 times 7, 14. 2 times 8, now y is 8. X multiplied y will make it 16. Okay? 2 times 7, 14. 2 times 8, 16. Now, this is finished. So it comes back and continues with next cycle of this outer loop. Here we have 3. 3 times 7, 21. 3 times 8, 24. Let's run this. And we see that result, okay? Now A is a list which contains the multiplication of two different lists. Of course, here, instead of putting this, we could have putting, for example, LST1, and LST1 can be equal to 2,3. This is also possible. We don't need to specify the list here. We can have here a list identifier. Here I have put several examples. So also we can have an if statement inside this. There are other more complicated cases, but I will not spend too much time. I will just finish comprehension here. If you have any questions about comprehension or lists, etc., please ask me now. Do you have any questions about lists and list comprehension?
No, teacher. Thank you.
Okay, let me continue with tuples quickly. I will not go to nested lists. Shall I spend some time to nest lists? Because if I spend time to nested lists, I will not start tuples today. Okay, I will leave tuples to next week and I will show you the nested lists. We can have a list containing other lists. Here we have a list, a second list, and a third list, and all those three lists are stored in another list. This type of lists are called nested lists. We can use nested lists for matrices. Okay. here inside the first list, inner list, we have the first row, the second row, the third row, and the fourth row. Here I have a matrix and another matrix. If I want to add elements of these two matrices, of course, I have to create nested loop. One loop will go from the first to the second, third, and fourth inner list, and the second one will go for the individual elements inside those lists, okay? In order to get these elements, we use the second loop, and the first loop is used to get the first row, the second row, the third row, the fourth row. How do we access these? For example, this element, what is the index of this element? The index of this element is addressed by two indexes, okay? We write, for example, this is M1. Where is M1? M1, yeah. Listen, we want to address this one. What is this? Let's copy these two. And let's go here. I want to address this one. So how do I address that? It is M1. Since there are nested, I will use two indexes. This is index 0, index 1, index 2. So this list, inner list, is at index 2. Inside this list, this is that one. M1, 2 is equal to this. Inside this 9 is at index 1. This is index 0, index 1. So M21 will address that specific element. 0, 1, 2, this is the first index. And inside 2, we have index 0, index 1. Is this clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay. I will not spend too much time how we multiply two matrices, how we get transpose of a matrix, etc. This is too complicated when we use matrices as nested lists. Instead of that, I will explain to you in a few weeks' time after file input output, we will have NumPy arrays. In NumPy arrays, we can easily create a multiply, get transpose of matrices with one single comment. So I will leave that to NumPy arrays. I will show you how NumPy arrays are created from the normal lists, how they are transposed, how their matrix multiplication is done, etc. There are just one dot method in NumPy arrays to multiply to have matrix multiplication in one line. I will here, for example, we have matrix MA, matrix MB, and MA dot dot MB returns us the matrix multiplication of MA and MB, and we start, for example, in MC. I'll show those things to you later on. So I will not spend today too much time to nested lists. Okay, here we have nested lists. As I told, matrices can be implemented with nested lists, but it is not a practical way of dealing with matrices in Python. In Python, if you will be working with matrices, it is much better to use NumPy arrays. All the engineers throughout the world that use matrices, vectors, etc., use NumPy arrays, which is a library, which is a Python library. And I will leave that subject to NumPy arrays. Okay, I will not spend much time about matrices and nested lists. All you have to know, for example, how do we address this one? This is index 0, index 1. So this whole list is index 1. So life 1 is life. If I have here 1, it is United States and 75.5. If I want to address this one inside this list, this is index 0, index 1. So life 1 and 1 will be 75.5, okay? All you have to know is just indexing nested lists. It is, in that case, you just put two square brackets. The first square bracket is to get the element, the related element of the matrix and of the list. And the second one is inside the chosen element in the big list. Okay. That's all I will tell today. Any questions about lists, nested lists so far? Okay. Then I will just do a very quick introduction to tuples, and I will, after 5-10 minutes of spending time to tuples, I will stop. A tuple is a collection of objects similar to lists. The difference is that when we write a tuple, we put parentheses before and after. But if I only have one element, I can create a single element list by using square bracket, square bracket and put one element. This is a list. But I cannot create a tuple using only one element. If I have parentheses is used for other purposes. So if I put here 7, this is not a tuple. This is a parenthesized expression which only contains 7. If I want to have a single element, I just put a comma here, okay? Now this is a tuple. Otherwise, without the comma, it is not a tuple. And if I want to create an empty tuple, empty tuples cannot be created with, for example, I can create an empty list using just this. This creates an empty list, but empty tuple can only be created by using the tuple method. We have tuple method. This creates a tuple, empty tuple. Only a close, open and close parentheses does not create an empty tuple. This creates an empty list, but this creates an empty tuple. This is not an empty tuple, okay? This is nothing. I want to be sure. Anyway, yeah. In order to create an empty tuple, use that one. And by the way, creating an empty tuple is absolutely unuseful because tuples are things that do not change at all. When you create a tuple, it never changes. You cannot add elements to the tuple. You cannot delete elements from a tuple. You cannot change values inside a tuple. So creating an empty tuple is quite useless. So we don't create an empty tuple. We always create some tuples. For example, I can create a tuple from range function 30, 41, 2. What it will do? It will create values 30, 32, 34, up to 40. And those are put in a tuple, okay? For example, we can put weekdays in a tuple because weekday name will not change at all. So instead of using a list, it is better to use a tuple if items will not change at all. The weekdays are fixed, they don't change. So it is better to use a tuple instead of a list for this kind of cases. Again, a tuple may contain a mixture of different types. We have strings here, we have numbers here. Also, we can create a tuple without putting any parentheses. We have something, comma, another thing, comma, another thing, comma, another thing. Parentheses can be omitted or may be omitted if you have multiple things separated with a comma. This is one element tuple. This is not a tuple. We can use tuple method and a range. We can have a list. From a list, we can use create a tuple. Lists are updatable, are mutable. Tuples are unmutable. So when we get this, TPL2 will not change at all. We can change later on some list. Some list may be changed. It's a list, but it will not affect TPL2, TPL2 is once created, never changes. We can create a list of characters from a string. If I have tuple followed by a string, it will create a tuple which contains the individual characters in that string. Okay. So this is one way of creating. This is a conversion from a string to a tuple. When a string is converted to a tuple, the individual characters are the elements of the tuple. The tuple slicing is same with lists. We can use plus operator. For example, we have tuple 1 and tuple 2. It will create a new tuple. Okay. TPL, TP2, TP3 is created like that. And by the way, we cannot change, we don't have any append or delete or extend type of methods with tuples because tuples are unmutable, but we can change something like that. Assume that we have a T1 is equal to, between parentheses, we have several numbers, 4, 5, 8. Sorry, I made a mistake. Parentheses here. Now I have this tuple. What I can do after some statements in my program, I can say T1 equal another tuple, okay? Now I did not change tuple. This is one tuple, this is fixed. After some time, what I did, I assigned to T1 variable another tuple. The tuple did not change, but T1 now is assigned another tuple, okay? This doesn't mean that T1 tuple is changed. No, that tuple is not changed. It is left somewhere else, but now T1 variable points to another tuple, okay? This is not changing tuples. This is assigning another tuple to T1. Don't mix these two. The in structure, in operator works with tuples as well. If we can have if x in TP1, it checks if the value of x exists in TP1. If x exists in TP1, it will return true. If x does not exist in TP1, it will return false. Again, we can have multiplication. It will repeat the elements of the tuple. It will create a new tuple, but the new tuple will again be unchangeable, but at the creation, the elements of the original tuple will be repeated, as we did in lists. And slicing is very, very similar to slicing lists or strings. The same principles apply, so I will not spend any time to explain this. Okay, this is the end of our lecture today. Any questions?
Do we have
responses
up to
yes, in the quiz this week, the tuples are included. Probably there will be one question from tuples, but there will be 2-3 questions from lists. And of course, all other subjects will have some questions. The emphasis will be on if statements, loops. Of course, range function is used in loops. What are the other subjects? Let me look to the top here. So selection statements are if statements. Loop, for loops and while loops will be used. You will have to write some functions in the quiz. There will be strings in the quiz, lists and tuples. Up to tuples, those will be the major subjects, okay? Including the selections. If statements, loops, functions, strings, lists and tuples are your responsibility.
Thank you.
You are welcome.
Can you please repeat what parts are we responsible for tomorrow?